George Clooney on the ticking time bomb that he says we can't ignore.
This is the place that's at most risk in the world right now.
He has President Obama's attention. Now he wants the world to wake up to a threat that could result in a million deaths.
They have been captured and they have been sold and they have been tortured and they have been raped and murdered.
Is time running out in Sudan? George Clooney for the Hour is next on Larry King Live. Good evening. By the way, I got a little catch in the throat tonight, so if you hear it sort of itching, that explains it. George Clooney is the Academy Award-winning actor and activist, just back from a trip to Southern Sudan, a region that Secretary of State Hillary Clinton describes as a ticking time bomb. With George's John Prendergast, he's traveled to the Southern Sudan with Mr. Clooney. He's the co-founder of the Enough Project. That's an anti-genocide advocacy organization. Co-author of the book, The Enough Moment, Fighting to End Africa's Worst Human Rights Crimes. They join us from the National Press Club in Washington. You know, when people hear your name, George, in connection with the Sudan, they probably think of Darfur, which is in the northwest. This time you were in the south. Why?
Well, we're in the south because there was a peace agreement. There was a war here that ended in 2005 with a peace agreement brokered by the United States. And they have the right now to vote for their independence from the north being the same people who acted against Darfur, the government of Khartoum, and who killed 2.5 million people in the South Sudan and killed 300,000 or 400,000 people in Darfur. They now have, the South has the right to vote for their own independence, and the international community, the president, the Congress, the UN, everyone believe that this is the place that's at most risk in the world right now.
Utmost risk in the world, a ticking time bomb. Why, George? Why there?
Well, I mean, it's sort of economics in a way. There's oil on the border. So the North wants to move the border further down because there's oil right on that edge. And the South wants to keep it because it's underneath their feet. And so there's economic reasons for it in general. There's a lot of reasons, believe me, it's very complicated. But that's a big one. It's, what's going to be required is some form of profit sharing, coming up with and designating where the actual border would be. There's a lot of complications to it. But right now, this is, you know, the governor of Khartoum has had two opportunities to act without war, and they've chosen war and atrocities. So to think that they wouldn't the third time when there's this much at stake would be naive at best.
John, how long were you there? Where'd you go?
Well, we went for a week on this last trip, and we traveled all over the border region, including to this little place about the size of Connecticut called Abyei, which everyone thinks if the war does begin again, it will begin there in Abyei. And we've got to figure out, as part of the diplomatic surge that the Obama administration has announced, figure out a way to address the concerns of the people that live there in the broader puzzle of the different interests of the two parties. It's all negotiable, and that's the good news. You know, the bad news is we only have 88 days till the referendum for Southern independence. The good news is we have 88 days in order to stop a war before it starts, and that's what our message was yesterday to President Obama, is to say this is something that can actually be prevented before it starts.
And how receptive was he, John?
Not only receptive, but I think ahead of the curve. And certainly we've been concerned that for the first year and a half of his administration, there wasn't enough attention placed on Sudan. But we've seen in the last couple of months the president himself become very seized with the issue of Sudan, Secretary of State and others in his administration, and we're starting to see some real action. So he wants to do more. The Republicans in the Senate and the House want to do more. We met with Richard Lugar yesterday from Indiana, Senator from Indiana, and we've met with a number of other representatives and senators. Everybody wants to do more. Now's the time to do it with such a short fuse left.
George, when you go to these places, or in this recent trip, what struck you the most?
Well, what struck us the most, that struck me the most, was their resolve. I mean, they are, they, to a person, not only are going to vote for independence, look, these are people that have been truly, you know, they have been captured and they have been sold and they have been tortured and they have been raped and murdered. And they believe they have a right for independence now and that the international community agreed to it. They believe that they're going to have that independence starting on the 9th of January. And to a man, to a person, they, every single one of them said they're willing to fight and die for that freedom. And that's they were very, that was the strongest thing we saw.
John, you know, the rest of the world hears about this. Such prominent people as yourself, George Clooney, go. We hear numbers. Do we turn away? Does the world care?
Well, the good news about Sudan and the remarkable thing, frankly, about Sudan is that you have, over the last 10 years, a developing constituency of conscience. People in the United States and around the world, rooted in churches and synagogues and universities and high schools, where students and people of faith respond to the suffering of the people of Sudan and say, indeed we are our brothers and sisters keepers, and we're going to do, we ought to do all we can. We don't have to send American troops. We don't have to spend tens of billions of dollars. We need to invest in a diplomacy to prevent and resolve the conflict in southern Sudan, resolve the conflict in Darfur, and bring peace to these people.
And also, Larry, I want to sort of add to that. When it's do we care, the truth is America has been and continues to be the most generous country on the planet. And, you know, the United States, not the government necessarily, a lot of it's NGOs, but we spend almost $1 billion there now. So we're already there and we're in it and we care. The question will be whether or not we're going to spend that money mopping up a massacre or whether we're going to be there trying to help prop up a new government.
By the way, if you'd like more information about the situation we're discussing tonight, go to SudanActionNow.org. More with George and John right after the break. Don't go away.
We felt like this was a chance to be able to stop, finally, stop a war before it starts. And that's the most important thing for Christmas. But there's an opportunity here not to start one, but to stop a war before it starts.
We're back with, you look up activism, you get pictures of George Clooney and John Prendergast. They were at the National Press Club in Washington. Did you, George, did you travel as private citizens or government auspices?
Private citizens. We're just, you know, what we heard over the last, this is something we've been planning for a bit of time now. It takes a little bit of planning to be able to sort of move inside the country. It's not very easy to do. But, you know, we looked around and thought, okay, there a lot of people here agree. Everyone agrees that there's a cloud, a dangerous cloud coming. The problem is that it needs to be amplified. You know, yes, everyone wants to do something. The president wants to do something. The Republicans have owned this issue as much, if not more, than the Democrats. Everybody wants to do it in a highly politicized time, maybe the most ever. Both sides agree, which we don't get much of. This is an opportunity for us as citizens to empower these, you know, our senators, our congressmen, our president, to do as much as he possibly can. Again, it's very important we keep saying this. This is not about spending money, and this is not about using troops. This is about what we do best, which is robust diplomacy.
John, does the UN have a strong presence in this?
The UN has $1 billion a year peacekeeping mission in southern Sudan to go along with the $1 billion a year peacekeeping mission in Darfur. So they're on the ground, not particularly effective, as effective as we'd like to see them be, much more, we'd like to see them be much more focused on protecting civilians. And the United Nations Security Council, while we were there, led by Susan Rice, American permanent representative to the UN, came, and they are going to look at how to strengthen the mandate. But they're there, so we have a huge infrastructure that's there. We have a vote looming on January 9. The United Nations can be the vehicle for getting those registration materials out, for ensuring that that vote can occur in as credible a fashion as possible.
What, George, is the worst case scenario here? What can happen before January 9th that should trouble us the most?
Well, what can happen before January 9th is that governor of Khartoum starts funding smaller groups to start fights, inner fighting, like he did with the Janjaweed going into Darfur, to create chaos so that he can say, hey, look, the South, it can't govern itself. The reality is, the worst case scenario, well, 2.5 million people died in the last war between the North and South that ended in 2005, and the South has a lot more guns and tanks now, so the South is better armed, which means this could really, truly be a very bloody war.
Why, John, has Khartoum always been a trouble spot?
Well, I think you got a government there that took power in 1989 by a military coup. Their aspirations were to create the first Islamic state. When oil began to be exploited, primarily thanks to the Chinese, the ideological fervor diminished, and the fervor for making as much money and stealing as much money from the state treasury as possible took its place. You've got a government there that has committed the worst atrocities imaginable, including genocide in Darfur, and maintained power by any means necessary. So that cocktail is a pretty lethal one. So our view is, through peace processes, A, we can prevent conflict between the North and the South and end the war in Darfur, but secondly, we can also begin to address that absolute power that exists in Khartoum and begin to democratize the country, allowing some competition, political parties, allowing some freedom of the press, and the kind of things that generally erode authoritarianism. So it's two, it's a bank shot. We're both looking for a peace around the country, but we're also looking long-term for the democratization of that country that will allow all people in Sudan to be free.